Hey, take your Bibles tonight to Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6. We're continuing on in our series on spiritual warfare and the armor of God. Tonight is the sword of the Spirit. The sword of the Spirit. What we're going to do tonight is normal. We'll start at verse 10. We'll read into and get down to verse number 18. Next week will be the last concluding message for our summer refresher. The reason why we do this is because normally we start the Wednesday after school lets out, and then we start the Wednesday, or we end, I'm sorry, we end the Wednesday previous to school starting back. But of course, we know school, we're not sure when school is going to start. Could be sometime in October, could be November. Might not even have school in 2020 and 2021 as a physical going to school. It might be all online. Maybe they'll send out coloring pages. Anyway, they'll do something. But what we're going to do is we're going to stop next week, and then we'll continue on with another series on 2 Peter and continue on there. Hey, the Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 10, Paul writes to the church at Ephesus, "Finally, my brother, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." Again, tonight I want to look at, if you would, the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And once again, as a way of introduction, I think it's important for us not to forget that God has provided us all the armor which we need. Amen. So that we will be victorious in spiritual battles. So it's our responsibility then to put on the armor of God. We're to literally put on the girdle of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the shield of faith, the helmet of salvation. And we understand that all of these are defensive parts of our armor, and they're which that we're to be saved from the attacks of Satan. So tonight I want to look at the only offensive weapon is the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And it's interesting to me that Roman soldiers, they clothe themselves, and it really is something important. If we see American soldier, Marine, someone that's in the Air Force, the Navy, or whatever, and they are ready to go into combat, all of the things that they have placed on their bodies are there for defensive purposes or for defensive reasons. And the same thing with the Roman soldiers. They clothe themselves in armor for defensive reasons. But we also know one thing for sure, that no soldier, no Marine, airman, sailor would ever go into battle without carrying at least one offensive weapon. I promise you this, in the midst of a battle, somebody shooting bullets at you, taking off your hat and throwing at them is not going to be a good defensive weapon or a good offensive weapon. Amen? It's not going to work. And so we have to have an offensive weapons. And we need to make sure we need to carry at least one offensive weapon. Here, and when Paul writes about the armor of God, he tells us, put on these things, but don't forget the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. That is our offensive weapon. Tonight, I want to look at a couple of things and apply this as the Word of God, and then look also at the sword this evening as well. Notice, first of all, the Word of God. The Word of God. And notice that the Word of God, that the author of the Bible, and I broke this down in three sections, we understand that the author of the Bible are individuals. I wrote down some kings, prophets, priests, judges, poet, cupbearer, tax collector, exiles, fishermen, herdsmen, farmers, shepherds, missionary, philosophers, statesmen. And so it's a variety of individuals. And it's interesting, when I look at this group, we see it goes from all the way to a king to a shepherd. And what a vast difference between these two groups. But understand, in the midst of all of that, these are individuals that were moved by the Holy Spirit of God to pen the words in the book in which we call today our Bible. We also notice the topics that are contained in this book. Its pages are filled with history, genealogy, law, ethics, prophecy, poetry, medicine, science, guidelines for diet, social and personal life, and even religion. And so we see numerous things that are contained also in this book. But here's something very important for us not to forget. The author is himself. It is God. The Bible says that he breathed out this book to us, that he's given it to us. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 1, it speaks about how the holy men of God were moved by the Holy Spirit of God to pen these words as they were directed by him. Remember this, he didn't dictate. What he did is that he guided them to write those words. They used their personalities, their speech, if you would, how they would write, but they're the ones that were behind the Spirit would guide them and direct them to put down exactly what he wants us to know. Notice the inspiration of the Bible. I have seven things that I put on there. I think it's important for us not to forget that the Word of God, above all other things, is infallible. Man. It is absolutely infallible. What exactly does that mean? Well, it's without error, it's faultless, it's flawless, it's absolutely perfect. We Man. Have the infallible Word of God. Notice something different. If this was written just by men, not moved by the Holy Spirit of God, then this book could be fallible. In fact, it's interesting to me, and I've used this illustration before. I like Lewis L'Amour and probably have read all the books that he's written. But it's always funny to me that a character can die in one book and be alive in the next book. Or the character could die one way and then he dies another way later on in the book. But notice one thing for sure. That's because it was written by fallible man. This book was written by infallible God. That's why it's consistent. That's why it's without error. That's why it's perfect. That's why it is absolute flawless. It's also inerrant. And I hear people say all the time, well, it's contained errors in the Bible. No, it's not. It's without error within its part. There is no error in its part of the Word of God. We also notice something important. Go with me to the book of Revelation, chapter 22. The book of Revelation, chapter 22. If you want verses, it's infallible, Psalm 19:7. It's inerrant in Proverbs, chapter 30, verse 5 and 6. It's complete, Revelation, chapter 22, verse 18 and verse number 19. For I testify unto every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man shall add unto these things, God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of the book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city and from the things which are written therein, written in this book. So notice something very important. This book is complete. We don't need to add any more books at the end, Man. In the middle, or at the beginning. We have all that God wants us to know. We don't need to have an extra book that we keep with this book, or we add to this book, or a library of books that we add to it. He has given us all that he wants us to know. God has revealed to us all that he wants us to know about him, about Christ, about the Holy Spirit of God, all that he wants us to know about the end times, all he wants to know about our salvation, all of those things he has given to us in this book. It's complete. And it's exactly what he wants us to know. You say, well, wait, what about the future? Is there more things that we ought to know? I have questions about this or a question about that. Hey, when we get into heaven, we'll know all things. Amen. Amen. And notice something important. His book is still complete. Just because we don't understand every bit about it, or we cannot comprehend everything about it, it doesn't mean the book's not complete. It just means that our knowledge about the book is incomplete. So the Word of God is complete. It's not to be added to, and any parts not to be taken away from it. I think this is also important because of it being infallible, inerrant, because it's complete. Understand this, that means it's authoritative. That it means that God is the one who speaks through the writers of the Bible. Because of all those things contained, then God has the authority then to speak to us through His Word. We also find that's Isaiah chapter 1 verse 2. In 2 Timothy 3:15 and 3:16, we find out the Word of God is sufficient. It's sufficient for salvation. And praise God, verse 17 of chapter 3 of 2 Timothy says that it's sufficient for our maturity, our growth as well. We know it's effective. Isaiah 55:11. I love this part. When the Word of God is spoken, listen to this, things happen, things occur. Because why? The Word of God never returns void, never returns empty. Something always happens. Amen. I remember years ago when I was going to Bible college, I took a class on the book of Acts. And one of the assignments that we were given is for us to go through the book of Acts from chapter 1, verse 1, all the way to the very end of the book, chapter 28. And we were to write down and record every time that we heard the Word of God, or we read the Word of God preached or presented, and we were to put the result. Can I tell you, there was always a result. Sometimes 3,000 came to Christ. 5,000 came to Christ. Sometimes the Word of God was received. But you know also what happened? Sometimes they were thrown into prison. Yeah. Sometimes they were ran out of town. Sometimes they were lowered down the basket. I can tell you this, the Word of God, when it's preached, there's always a result. Something Man. Always happens. Hey, it might not be what we want it to happen, but something always happens. Man. Hey, we might like to see the altars full and thousands come to Christ when all we do is open our mouth and we say, "Thus saith the Lord." But notice something important. That might not be what God desires to happen. But maybe you understand this. When the Word of God is spoken, it is effective. Things do happen. We also know it's divine. Holy men of God wrote as directed by the Spirit of God. So we see the inspiration of this book. And notice something important again. When we see in Ephesians chapter 6 that the Apostle Paul said, "And the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God." And so we see that we have a vital tool, a vital weapon that we're to use. But notice also the resources of the Bible, the resources of the Bible. And you'll see why this is so important here just in a few minutes, that we understand, we comprehend what the resources of the Bible, what they can do and what exactly they are. Notice, it's a source of truth. John 17:17. It's the truth about life and death, time and eternity, heaven and hell, right and wrong, men and women, old people, young people. It's a truth about relationships. So it's a source of truth. Today, the world will tell us this is what they think the truth is, or what situation ethics is. Or, in other words, situation ethics is that we change our ethics according to the situation. Like, for instance, I'm hungry, I have no money, so the situation says it is okay for me to go to 7-Eleven, go to Fry's, go to Walmart, go into a restaurant someplace, to take food from off the shelf, pack it down in my pants, pack it in the side of a bag, and run out of the place and begin to sit down and eat that food. Because see, the situation called for, I'm hungry, and so the ethics of paying for it and not stealing, it goes out the window. I'm hungry. So now I can eat first and worry about the ethics later. Amen? It's more important that I get my belly full than it is for me to be honest. Understand that? In fact, that's exactly what sin is. Sin is taking legitimate needs and filling them illegitimately. Get that? It's fulfilling legitimate needs illegitimately. And so notice, it's a source of truth. The Bible, one thing for sure, the Bible's truth never changes. The Bible's truth never changes. Number two, it's a source of happiness. Because of the truth the Bible contains, it brings happiness. One thing for sure, when we are secure, we're a happy people. Yeah. You notice that? Yeah. When there's security in a marriage, it's a happy spouses. Security in a family, it's happy children. Security in a church, happy church. Security in a nation, a happy nation. But once that we lose that security, then what happens to us? There's unhappiness, there's unrest. And so notice something important. The Bible's the source of happiness. It's also the source of growth. 1 Peter 1:22 says that we are to drink of the milk of the Word of God, so thereby we may grow. We also notice in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse number 18, that we are to grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. So it's a source of growth. Hey, praise God. Look at Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 12 with me. Hebrews chapter 4, verse number 12. We notice in Hebrews chapter 12, it's a source of power. For the word of God is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword.
Amen.
Piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit, of the joints and the marrow. It's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. Guess what? The word of God is the first thought police. It's not, we don't know what someone thinks. Oh, we can look on their face and we can think, well, I think I know what they think because I can see their countenance. I can see the expression. I can see if they have a smile that they must be happy. But I don't know if they're happy or not. There's a lot of folks today that walk around with this kind of grin on their face. And inside, man, their hearts might be broken.
That's right.
There might be somebody walking around and they have a frown on their face. But yet inside their heart might be rejoicing. Hey, there might be folks that have tears running down their eyes, and we think that they're weeping because of grief or sorrow. But in reality, they could be weeping because of joy, or something's moved their heart to cause them to weep. But notice something important about the Word of God. It's quick, it's powerful, it's sharper. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of even our heart. It's the source of power. We become impotent if we do not use the Word of God for living. In a book of Psalms 119, 105, it's a lamp and a light to guide us on the right path. So it's a source of guidance. In Romans chapter 15, verse number 4, it's a source of comfort. There's comfort contained in its pages. It's concerning hope, eternity, and help. And once again, it's a source of perfection. It's to bring us to maturity and righteousness in our lives. And praise God, according to Ephesians chapter 6, it's the source of victory.
Amen.
The source of victory. See, it reveals the armor that we need to put on so that we can be victorious over Satan, victorious over sin, and the greatest enemy that we have, victorious over even ourselves. So we notice the Word of God. And we notice the importance about the Word of God because he tells us, take the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And again, the reason why I put down these eight things about the resources of the Bible, you'll notice here just in a few seconds, just bear with me and we'll get to them tonight. So notice the swords, because he speaks about the sword of the Spirit. Well, there's two Roman swords. There is a broadsword, which is the Greek word, rhamphia. And what this means, it means a saber. The one that you would use both hands with to chop down, to begin to swing around, to come down upon the skull, if you would, we talked about last week. That's why we need to have on the helmet of salvation, that protection in our mind. It's found, by the way, seven times in seven verses. It's found one time in the Gospels, and it's found six times in the book of Revelation. But there's also another type of a sword, and that's the type that they're speaking of here in Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 17. And it's a dagger. It's the Greek word, makahira, and it means a knife, something that's small. And it's interesting to me that the Roman soldier wouldn't always carry the saber, but they always carried the dagger. They always carried this sword, this short knife, if you would. It's a normal sword carried by soldiers. It's approximately 18 inches long. And the reason why they carried it is because when someone got close to them to hand-to-hand combat, it'd be difficult for them to swing the broadsword when someone is short and someone is so close to them. So guess what they'd use? They would use this dagger in hand-to-hand combat, in close quarters of fighting. And so due to its size, it could be used with precision. So they would know that these individuals, these warriors, and these soldiers that are going out to fight with this dagger, they would practice using it. And they would practice using it to perfection. They would know how to come down and cut and how to go in and thrust and all the rest of those things. So they would be able to use it in such a fashion and such a way that they would be victorious in hand-to-hand combat. It was usually carried in a sheath or a scabbard along their side. It's found in the New Testament, by the way. This word for this dagger, this knife, is found 29 times in 26 verses. I put down 5 examples of it. We notice that when they came to Jesus, they came with a sword. Jesus came with a sword in Matthew chapter 10, verse 34 to 35. He says, "You think I came with peace, but he says, I've come with a dagger. I've come with a sword for hand-to-hand combat, for close quarters fighting." This is the same thing that the Apostle Peter used to cut off the ear of Malchus, the servant of the high priest. I couldn't imagine that here's Peter there standing next to Jesus, and the servant of the high priest is standing there, and Peter pulls out a saber or a broadsword and begins to swing it back and forth, like they see sometimes these kids, these lightsabers, and here he is, comes down upon this guy's ear. Notice, if he used a saber or a broadsword, he would not have just cut off his ear. He probably would have crushed his skull, or would have come down and cut off his ear and probably sliced, if you would, his shoulder or clavicle or whatever else, and would have crushed him. In Acts chapter 12, verse 2, James, the brother of John, was killed by this dagger, this sword, this knife. In Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, this is what's described as the Bible as a two-edged sword, able to divide between what? Soul and spirit, the intents and thoughts of the heart. Notice, again, if we used a broadsword, could you imagine them going into surgery and you say, well, what do you want to use to do an operation on someone's heart? Well, give me the biggest knife that you have. I want a cleaver to go in there and divide these arteries from these veins. And that doesn't make any sense. And so does when God begins to do heart surgery upon us, upon the intents and thoughts of our heart, what's he going to use? Praise God, he doesn't use a cleaver or a broadsword. He uses a dagger and gets in there the minute parts and begins to divide the thoughts from the intents, the soul from the spirit, and not using a broadsword because he would do more damage than he would if he goes in to do some surgery upon us. It's the same word, by the way, used in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 34 and verse 37. It was used against the heroes of the faith. So we see the Roman swords. We see the concept of using a saber, a broadsword for destruction, or using this dagger to begin to go in there and cut hand-to-hand combat. And so he tells us that we're to use the sword of the Spirit. We are to use the dagger. We're not to use a broadsword. And yet sometimes, unfortunately, we as Christians, I believe we do use a broadsword on folks. In fact, that's the reason why the Bible says that our speech ought to be what? It ought to be salted. It ought to be something full of love, salted with love. It ought to be layered with love. Remember this, that our speech, without love, is hypocrisy. And our speech with love, that we need to make sure that it's kind and gentle, and we use exactly what we need to have. And so we notice the Roman swords. We also see the Christian sword. And we see the explanation of the Christian sword. And there's two words, or two different Greek words, that are used for the word in the New Testament. There is the word logos, that's found in John chapter 1, verse number 1, when it speaks that Jesus is the Word. And that's speaking of the logos. It's found 330 times in 316 verses. It means something said, and it refers to thought. It speaks of Jesus Christ, the living Word, but it also refers to the written Word in Scriptures as well. But that's not the word that's found here. This, which is the Word of God found in Ephesians chapter 6, verse number 17, is the word rhema. It's found 70 times in 67 verses. And this is what it means. It means an utterance. An utterance. In fact, if you go back to Matthew chapter 4, you notice when Jesus spoke to Satan, when he was being tempted in the wilderness, he did not use, if you would, logos, because he was the logos, but he uses rhema. He gave an utterance. He referred back to the book of Deuteronomy. He used Deuteronomy three different occasions to speak to him and show him that the untruth that Satan was trying to draw Jesus to. And so he used an utterance. It refers to a matter or a topic. Now remember, a few minutes ago I said that the Bible had resources, and I gave you eight different resources of the Bible. I said it's the resource of truth, of happiness, of growth, of power, guidance, comfort, perfection, and victory. And I said it's really important for us to understand why those things are so important to us. Here's the reason why. It's because the sword that we have as an offensive weapon is contained in the Word of God. See, we're not to go around with the Word of God and beating people with it. He said the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. And so it doesn't mean we take the logos, the written word, and we pound on people. But we take the rhema. And so the concept is just this. Using a military illustration, the Bible is an armory. And an armory is where all the weapons of war are stored. And they're stored there until when? Until they're needed. In fact, when I was in the military, when I first went in over to Korea, one of my very first jobs, because I just got there, and they went on alert, all the base cleared out, and I was left there, and one of my responsibilities is to secure the armory. First, we handed out weapons, and then we secured it when all the weapons were done, made sure we took an account of what weaponry was still left in the armory, etc., etc. And the important thing was, the reason why we handed out those weapons when our base went on alert is because individuals did not carry their weaponry with them. It was left in the armory. Notice the same thing. If the Bible's the complete armory in which we need, this is where all the weapons of war are stored until they're needed. Until we go and receive it. Until we need to glean and pull from it. See, the sayings, the principles, the doctrine contained in the Bible are part of the armor of God. Understand the reason why this is so important? Because look at, when we get defeated, what do we need to do? We need to know where the source of victory is. Man. See, notice this. It's great. You ever look at the Bible before? And some of you already know this. I have three Bibles. They're exactly the same. I have a Bible I preach out of, exactly the same as the Bible that I have on my end table at home, where I sit and read my Bible in the morning. And the same Bible I have in my office at home is exactly, all three of them are exactly the same Bibles. All the covers are different. This is black. The one that sits by my table at home is purple or a maroon color. The one in my office is blue. But they're all exactly the same. In other words, the reason why they're the same is when I open up this, and I think, you know, there's a verse that I read today, and I know that it's someplace today. I've been reading the book of Isaiah, and I know it's in the book of Isaiah. And I know it's on the left-hand side of my page. So guess what I'm doing? I can go to the book of Isaiah. I know today I read up until about chapter 16. And so about chapter 14, 15, 16, someplace in there was a verse I wanted. So I know exactly where to go to pull that out. Get the idea? So if I want victory, and I need to be able to pull on victory, or I need victory today, I don't want to talk about, you know, husbands love your wives. Man, I need to have victory in my life today. Oh, I don't want to leave about children. You're to be obedient to your parents. I want to be able to glean something. I don't want to talk about unity. That's not what I need. I need something to do with victory. So I need to know where to pull from that armory for victory. Got the idea? You ever sit sometimes in your Bible and say, man, there's a verse that I want and I can't remember exactly how it goes? And so what do you end up doing? You begin to pull from that verse. In other words, Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. It's not good if I need hope today or if I need comfort today. Hey, it's great to know security that God's in charge of all things, but that might not be what I need. Get the concept that I'm trying to get at? So we need to know where to pull the resources from. That's exactly what we're talking about when he says the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Yes, it's the word of God. Control the logos. But when we need the logos, we need to know to open it up and find out where the rhema is. Where's the source? Where's the concept, the verse, the doctrine in which I need today? That's what Paul's speaking about. The sword of the Spirit. Could you imagine Jesus being in the wilderness? Turn to Matthew chapter 4 with me. Bear with me as I chase this rabbit just for a few more minutes to make sure we got the concept. Matthew chapter 4, verse number 1. Then Jesus led up of the Spirit in the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. When he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward a hunger. When the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. Jesus says, I'm the Logos. No. Now, would that have anything to do with him talking about bread? No. He says, man, you've got to have this bread, food, you're hungry. Like the Bible says, Jesus afterward was a hunger. So what does Jesus need to do? Satan's coming to him, trying to give him or tempt him with food. So what does Jesus say? Man shall not live by bread alone, but man, by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. He didn't say to Satan. Then Satan says, here, take this bread. Command these stones to be bread. And Jesus says, wait a minute, I'm coming back again. Get the idea? That's not what Jesus needed to say to Satan. Jesus needed to say to Satan, man shall not live by bread alone. Get the idea I'm trying to get at now? So we need to know what to pull out when we need it. What we need. Hey, if I'm thirsty, I don't go to the cupboard and eat crackers. Or peanut butter and crackers. That's even worse. Because I'll be like this. Because that peanut butter just seems like when you're thirsty, it begins to swell up. And saltine crackers, it seems like to just break in your mouth. It's always interesting to me. Years ago, we were in a church and I had someone in charge of the bread and the juice for communion. And the guy came in one time and he had these wafers. Man, they were about yay big. They were like the normal dried wafers, unleavened bread wafers. He had these big old things. And I remember my wife said, man, I can't eat these things. Before we just take a little tiny swallow of juice. And you got this cracker and you're trying to just stick it to your mouth and stick it everywhere. And you think it's hard enough for folks sitting in the pew. Imagine standing up and trying to speak and your mouth is dry. And then you got this wafer in your mouth. You're trying to say, and so you get the concept. We didn't know exactly what we need. So we don't choke on one thing, but we draw exactly what we have to have. Notice the explanation. Number two, it's spiritual. See, the sword in the spiritual sense, that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal or temporal. Our weapons of our warfare is spiritual. All these weapons that we give and we glean from in Ephesians chapter 6 are all spiritual. See, we're not walking around. In fact, I don't have a coat of a breastplate sitting at home. I don't have shoes for the gospel of peace at home in my shoe where my shoes are. I don't have those things. Those are spiritual. And so the weapons in which we use are spiritual. Because the weapons of our warfare, according to 2 Corinthians chapter 10, they're not carnal. They are not temporal. So all the pieces of the believer's armor is spiritual. But not only is it spiritual, it's been given to us by who? By the Spirit of God. Because each part of our weaponry is spiritual, it can only be given to us by the Spirit of God. See, when we read the Bible, the Spirit applies exactly what we need to strengthen our faith.
Amen.
You ever spend time and your heart's just kind of just got some issues in your life and you've just got a burden that you're carrying and you go to God and you say, Lord, would you just help me? And would you just direct me to what exactly do I need? And what happens? The Spirit of God begins to guide us and direct us to exactly what we need.
Amen.
You ever notice when we're depressed and discouraged, he never leads us to Acts chapter 1, where it talks about Judas Iscariot hanging himself? It never leads us there, amen? It always leads us somewhere else. It takes us to exactly where we need to be. So notice two things, and I'm done. It's capabilities. We notice defensively that when Satan attacks us with the doubts and temptations, we can reflect his blows with the proper use of the Word of God. But notice, again, and I've said this so many times, how important it is. We need to know the Word of God so we know what part to use when we're being attacked. We need to know where it is. You know, I could not imagine, and I know it's a tragedy today, that we even have to do this. But today we know that some of the men in our church carry guns. And I like the concept that when I look, I notice that they have a clip. And I'm pretty sure in the clip there's bullets that are ready to be used if someone comes in to try to harm our church. Man. What good is it if we have the clip over there and the weapon over there and someone comes in and we're trying to put everything together? I believe it's the same thing when Satan attacks us. We need to know exactly where to go. We need to know exactly where to glean. We need to know exactly what verse will speak to our hearts, what verse will encourage us, how to apply what we read. And if we begin to neglect the Word of God, I promise you this, we will not be victorious believers. We'll become discouraged, disappointed, and defeated.
Amen.
In our Christian life upon this earth. So it's a defensive weapon. But also notice something important. It's also an offensive weapon. See, when Satan attacks, we are to think of verses to encourage, to strengthen, to empower us so that we might be able to withstand his onslaught. We need to be able to know. Now, I might not know every verse. In fact, I've been misquoting a verse about the last week. And I have this verse in my mind, and I know what it means, and I keep on over my mind, I'm misquoting it. And finally, yesterday, I sat down, and I went to the scripture, and I read the verse, and said, well, I got the general concept. I'm just saying it wrong. But understand something. I don't want to say it wrong.
Amen.
And I don't want to memorize it wrong. And I don't want to have a different concept of it. I want to know exactly what that verse says to me. I want to know exactly what it says, and I want to know exactly the correct interpretation of that verse, exactly how each word is laid out. I want to know what the Bible says. And if I'm doing everything else but looking at the Word of God, what's it going to do to me? It's going to draw me away, and it won't be the strength that I need. It won't be the help that I need. It won't be the benefit that I need. It won't bring me encouragement. It won't bring me strength. And I guarantee you, it will not empower me to withstand the onslaughts of Satan. Man, that's why he speaks. Take up what? The sword of the Spirit, which is the Rama. Knowing the armory is the Bible and the part that I need to pull out to be able to use correctly and be able to use it rightly. Because I'm doing hand-to-hand combat. I don't need the broadsword. Man, I need the dagger. Because I need to know exactly how to pull the resources from the Word of God. Satan is a slick enemy. He knows the Bible, and he knows how to take the Bible and twist it and turn it to make sure that he begins to cause confusion to us. We need to be able to know the Word of God in such a fashion, in such a way, that when he comes and tries to twist it, we know it's been twisted so that we can begin to say exactly what the truth is. Amen. Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you it's the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. I thank you, Father, for the resources. I thank you, Father, for the inspiration. It's infallible. It's complete. It's all that we need. We thank you, Father, that we can glean from it. We thank you, Lord, that we can carry it. We can read it. We can study it. We can memorize it. We can apply it to our lives. Father, be with each one of us tonight. We just give you thanks. And Lord, we know that Satan will never weary in battling us until finally you begin to take us home. And so, Father, we understand these last days, the onslaught will be greater than ever before. Keep us strong in you. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord bless you.